Okay, we can start. So we have seen how to draw both the plots. Now I want to show some short examples on MATLAB on what these both the plots look like. And I hope the things will work here. So now I will share. So for the example, we'll see it's a binomial term. Let's begin with the monomial term. For example, now okay, what you see here what you see here is the Bode plot of a monomial term, denominator monomial term. So remember that we have seen, so notice the two plots, magnitude and phase of the Bode plot. So the magnitude is the module. okay, in dB decibel, and the phase is in degree or radians as you want. The frequency you see is in radians per second. So this is the term 1 over s, so monomial term, denominator monomial term. So we have seen that a monomial term, actually we have seen a numerator monomial term, the magnitude is a linear function, okay, with rate 20 dB per decade, and passes through the point 0 dB omega equal to 1. Okay? So remember that the denominator terms differ from the numerator terms in that you have to change sign, both magnitude and phase. As a matter of fact, you see, the magnitude is exactly the opposite of the magnitude of a numerator monomial term. And you see that the rate is minus 20 dB per decade. So it's decreasing. Moreover, if you see here, this is the frequency equal to 1. No, here, excuse me. Here is frequency equal to 1, 10 to 0 power. This is 1. You notice also we are over one decade here. Only one decade is shown. You see, from 1 to 10, not four decades. Only one decade. Okay, this is due to the program. So you can decide which decades to see. And you see that the point through which the line is passing is exactly 0 dB 1. 0 decibel with omega equal to 1. Moreover, the rate, if you see, is exactly minus 20 dB per decade, because we are over a decade, and you see that the decrement is exactly 20 dB over a decade. Okay? So this is exactly the term we had drawn in the last lesson, with the difference that we have seen the numerator term. So, moreover, you see the phase. Remember that the phase for the numerator monomial term is 90 degrees. So here we have a denominator monomial term, and so the phase will be opposite. So minus 90 degrees. And you see that it is a constant function passing through 90, the value, having the constant value minus 90 degrees. Okay. Usually the instructions here in MATLAB, you have to declare a variable num usually, if you want. The name doesn't matter. And put the coefficients of the polynomials for numerator and denominators in decreasing order. So, for example, now if we want to represent 1 over 1 plus s, which is a binomial term, a denominator binomial term, for the numerator part, we will set num equal to the unique coefficients we have, which is 1. Okay, 1 over s plus 1. And for the den, you set starting from the highest power, which is s plus 1, so 1, 1. Okay, one coefficient of S and one the constant coefficient. And now you launch the instruction bode num den, numerator denominator. Okay, let's. Okay. I don't see the window. Where is the window? Okay, let's exit. Ok. Okay, so now you are seeing a binomial term with tau equal 1, binomial denominator term. So it is 1 over 1 plus s. 1 over 1 plus s. Binomial term, denominator term with tau equal 1. So remember, this is the exact plot. So remember the approximate one, which is 0 dB up to the cutoff frequency. The cutoff frequency here, since tau is 1, because remember the cutoff frequency is 1 over tau. So it is this. This is the cutoff frequency. So our approximated Bode plot will be zero up to the cutoff frequency, so up to this point, and then decreasing. Remember that this is the denominator term with tau positive. So the magnitude will be zero up to this point, which is the cutoff frequency, and then decreasing with 20 dB per decade. As a matter of fact, you see that the only differing part here is this with respect to the approximated plot, which is exactly around the cutoff frequency. Okay, so here the rate, as you can see, as you can see from the scales, is exactly 20, minus 20 dB per decade. Okay? So actually, in the lesson we have seen the numerator binomial term, and so remember that the rate was positive, so 20 dB per decade. But now we have a denominator term, so we have minus the same rate, so it's decreasing. Okay, and this is the magnitude. This is the exact magnitude. About the phase, you see, remember what we had. The approximated, first of all, remember that the phase must be changed, the sign of the phase must be changed with respect to the numerator phase we have seen in the last lesson. So the phase will go, remember, from zero decreasing to minus 90 degrees. This is the phase of a binomial denominator term with tau positive. Okay, so again, this is the exact phase, and the approximated phase, if you remember, is zero up to one decade before the cutoff frequency, which in this case is 10 to minus one. So 0.1 here. Here is exactly one decade before. So zero up to this point, and then you go on the other side, minus 90 degrees from one decade after the cutoff frequency, which now is 10. The cutoff frequency is one. So one decade, 10. So from 10 on, frequency 10 on, the value of the phase will be minus 90 constantly. This is the approximated function. And then you have to join with a linear function the two values. Okay. So you have, instead of this, you see this nonlinear curve inside here from this point to this point, as we have seen in the lesson, we have a linear interpolation. Okay. And the linear interpolation, remember, will pass, however, through this point here, which is minus 45 degrees cutoff frequency. One. It's the intermediate point. Okay, so I want to show a final, another one example in which we mix together. So what we have to do when we have more than one simple or Bode term? We have to sum all the contribution at each frequency, and then we get the overall Bode plot. So let's see, for example, the Bode plot of 1 over s multiplied 1 plus s. So the multiplication of the two Bode plots of the two functions. Okay, we obtain this again as numerator is 1. And now denominator, you have to multiply all the terms to get the polynomial form of this. So if you have a denominator, you have s multiplied s plus one. This is s squared plus s, okay? So you declare here s squared plus s is, starting from the power, the maximum power, you have the coefficients 1, 1, 0. Too many commas, okay. Excuse me. Okay, and now launch the Bode instruction. Okay, Now you see, basically, and this is exactly the sum of the two exact Bode plots we had before. And notice that the rate of the magnitude is not anymore constant. And the reason is that you are summing two contributions, two functions which are different rates or equal rates. But remember, the monomial term has a constant rate equal to minus 20 dB per decades. The binomial term has the same rate, but only after. Remember that it is zero before the cutoff point. So it is not contributing in the rate before the cutoff frequency. So for this reason, you see that exactly at the cutoff frequency, you see, here, one, before the cutoff frequency, you have a rate minus 20 dB per decade, which is exactly the contribution of 1 over S. After the cutoff frequency, you have the rate doubled. Okay, you see, this is minus 40 per dB per decades. And this is due to the fact that you are summing two terms which have the rate minus 20 dB per decade, which sum up to minus 40. Okay, and so you have this new rate, which is the sum of the rates. Okay, a very similar situation you have with the phase. Remember that the phase of 1 over S is minus 90 degrees constantly. And the phase of the binomial term is something which goes from 0 decreasing to minus 90. So you see that with low frequencies, so very close to zero, you start, the phase starts from minus 90, because this is the fixed, the constant contribution of the monomial term. Then you see that at a certain frequency, you will enter the contribution of the binomial term, denominator binomial term. Okay, and so the phase is now starting to decrease. In particular, the phase will decrease by exactly 90 degrees, basically over two decades. Remember the phase of the binomial term decreases, the approximated at least one. The phase decreases by 90 degrees over two decades. And so you see that the phase now will go from minus 90 to minus 180 degrees. So basically is the translation of the binomial term, of the phase of the binomial term, by exactly the constant phase of the monomial term. Okay. We can see another, a final, more complicated example. So let's introduce, for example, a binomial numerator term. So a binomial numerator term, the binomial numerator term, for example, will be 1 plus 3s. So now the declaration here is this, 1 plus 3s. So coefficients will be 3, 1. The denominator will be the same. So we are only adding a numerator binomial term. So the final function is 1 plus 3s over s multiplied 1 plus s. Okay. So obviously these are approximated, but are exact. But the approximated plots you will get, they will be very, very similar. Now you see what happens. At least you can interpret qualitatively this. You see again, the initial rate is minus 20 dBs per decade. This, and this is due to the monomial term. After you see that basically we have, remember that the binomial numerator term is 1 over 3s. So this means that the cutoff frequency of the numerator term is 1 over 3, which is less than what? The cutoff frequency of the denominator term, which is 1. So this means that the action of the numerator term will begin before the action or the contribution of the binomial denominator term. And so for this reason, the rate is decreasing. So basically what happens is that the rate tend to be zero because the rate of the numerator term is 20 dB per decade, while the rate of the monomial term is minus 20. So it's clear that the numerator term, the denominator term is not acting at this point, tends to zero the effect of the rate or the rate of the monomial term. So for this reason, you have this sort of flattening of the curve. Actually, in your approximated plot, you will get something which is completely flat. It's constant. Then you see the rate become the same as the initial one because now you have the contribution from here, from some frequency around here on. In particular, the approximated one will begin to act when at its cutoff frequency, which is 1. Okay. So the action, the contribution of the binomial term now is that of compensating the denominator term or compensating the numerator term. They have opposite rates. And for this reason, the final rate in this interval of frequency becomes again the initial one. So minus 20 per decade. Okay, so basically remains the contribution of the monomial term. Okay, because the denominator binomial term is compensating the numerator term in some sense from the point of view of the rates. They have opposite rates. And so the final rate is minus 20 per the dB per decade. Okay, let's see the phase. You see that the phase starts from minus 90 for low frequencies. And this obviously is due to the action of the monomial term. Okay, now remember that the cutoff frequency of the numerator term is less than the cutoff frequency of the denominator term. So it is the numerator term that contributes first in terms of frequencies. So you will see before, You will see first the contribution of the numerator term. The phase of a numerator binomial term is increasing from 0 to 90. Okay, so you see what happens is that the phase becomes increasing. Okay. Or starts increasing. Notice that, however, it will never reach the value zero. What we expect now is that the numerator term, the phase will go from zero to 90. So if we should not have the denominator term, the phase will be completely compensated and then should go to zero. Minus 90, increasing zero. However, at the cutoff frequency 1, you see, basically becomes significant the denominator term. And so the effect is that to compensate the phase of the numerator term. And for this reason, the phase is getting back to its initial value. Okay? So now again, decreasing. And from, you see, approximately one decade after, the cutoff frequency of the denominator term, around which the values of the phase are exactly 90 or minus 90. So the phases of the two binomial terms are exactly compensating, basically. And so you remain with the phase of the monomial term. Okay. So in this way you can obtain any function, basically. You have only to draw the Bode plots of the single terms. The single terms and then sum. I want to show finally only a denominator term, a trinomial denominator term, for example, we choose s squared plus s plus 1. Okay, this is a trinomial term with zeta equal to 0.5. So you see what happens and what we predicted basically in our lessons. There is a difference with, you see, actually the square of a binomial term. And the difference is exactly here, is can be appreciated with the, you see, the magnitude is something which is zero, basically, up to, say, one. As a matter of fact, here, the natural frequency is one, omega n. For this trinomial term, the natural frequency is one, which is this. So you see that you have basically 0 dB up to the natural frequency. However, you see that the actual function has here as a sort of peak, you see? What is not a behavior, for example, of a double binomial term, of the square of a binomial term. The square of a binomial term won't show something like this, so a peak like this. So this peak is typical of the trinomial term. Okay, this peak. Remember that this peak will be bigger. With basically the damping. So the smaller is the damping, the larger will be that peak. No? As a matter of fact, now we will reduce in the next example, we will reduce the damping and we will see that the peak is increasing. And actually, we have seen this in our last lesson. Remember that we have seen the numerator trinomial term. So remember that you have something like a peak downward. And as the damping tends to zero, the peak tends to open. And so if finally, in the limit for the damping being zero, you have an asymptote to minus infinity. Now you have to reverse the picture. So the peak is going, because you have a denominator term, it's going to infinity. So notice that the phase is very similar to that of a binomial term, but you see that the limit values are 0 and minus 180 degrees. So it's similar to the phase of the square of or the product of two binomial terms, basically. Okay. Now, if we reduce the damping, you see. Now, what I'm representing is 1 over s square plus 0.01s plus 1. Now, the damping has been reduced by a factor 100 with respect to the previous example. So, notice the peak. Is higher and its amplitude is 40 dBs. Okay. Notice the constant values, approximately constant values 0. Remember the asymptotic values of the trinomial term. And then here the rate, which is minus 40 dBs per decade. You see from here, around the natural frequency, is exactly here, 1. You see that it is not possible to approximate a trinomial term for any value of the damping with the magnitude of a double binomial term, because you are not taking into account the presence of this peak otherwise. Notice the phase as it is very close to be something which is almost discontinuous at the natural frequency. You see, this is kind of almost a jump from zero to minus 180s. Okay. However, it is still continuous. Okay, so you can use MATLAB to check MATLAB is a program which you can download with the campus license. Can have fun with MATLAB. Exactly. Checking, for example, what you do approximately on your piece of paper, and then you can check on MATLAB. Okay, so we can close this simulation here. And we get back. To us here. Okay, so we basically leave this topic. So we concluded this topic. We will get back to this to both the plots when we will see control methodologies for. In the S domain, in the frequency domain. Now, instead, we want to tackle the problem of control design in state space. So we will start to see a certain number of problems, of control problems. Which will solve on the time domain model. So, in this part of the course, now we'll focus on the time domain model and a certain number of important control problems. And we will see in detail how to solve these problems and to obtain the corresponding control laws. In a second part, we will see basically the corresponding control design methodologies for the frequency model, the input-output model. So in Laplace or frequency domain. And so also in that domain, we will solve a certain number of control problems. And in that occasion, we will need the Bode plots. Okay, so now we get back to time domain model. Okay, so a first important problem we want to see is this. So if we are given a point in the state space x0, and a final point in XF, what we want to see is how to find the function u of t, the input or the control function. In particular, we want to find here a control function as a time function. We will see that we'll see other kind of problems in which the input we want to design or find is instead a function of the state itself. And the difference is that if you design a time function, you are not basically implementing a feedback from the state. If you design a function, an input, which is function of the state, basically you are implementing a feedback law. Okay? So, this means that U here is a feedback law from the state, so you see that this kind of laws correspond or controls correspond to loop, to a loop you are closing around the system, you see. Because the input will be a function of the state or the output, any. Okay. Instead here, we want to find u of t as a function of time. So no feedback. In general, there is an important difference between this kind of functions, or you see, or say control laws. In general, these are open loop controls, and these are closed loop controls. And the reason is that the open loop controls that in general does not take into account the values of the state of the output. So it's something which you apply to the system, whatever is the value of the state or the output. Instead, the closed loop controls control the system on the base of the values of the state or the output. However, we should say that the first kind of controls suffer from kind of lack of robustness, in the sense that if you have some change in the parameter of the system, since the values of the controls, the inputs, are not based on the values of the state or the output, you will not be able to detect these changes from the point of view of the control. So for this reason, these kind of controls are weaker than these kind of controls from this point of view. Okay. So find a control u of t for which we are able to steer. Steer means drive. To bring the point. To steer the solution of the system from x0 in xf. So it's a point-to-point control problem. So we want to steer the state of the system from an initial given value to a final given value. And all of this in a prescribed time, TF. Okay. So to this is clearly an important problem because by doing this we are able to bring the system from an initial state to a final state in a certain time. So, for example, this kind of problems may arise from appointment problems or any problem like this. We need to, for example, implement some kind of maneuver or docking. Okay. So, behind the solution of this problem, there is the notion of reachability. So a state XF is reachable from X0 a time TF. If this is a definition, there exists an input function U of T such that the solution of the system a time tf, remember that xt, x0, u denotes the solution of the system with input u and initial value x0. A time initial value input function time at which we are considering the solution. So you see, this means that the solution at time tf with input u and starting from x0 is xf. So basically, this means that a certain time TF, the state will be in XF, starting from X0. So we say this by saying that state XF is reachable from X0 in time TF. Okay, a first important property of reachable set of the set of reachable states is this. So consider the reachable states XF from X0. So we have a certain set, which is the set of states which are reachable from x0 equal 0, so from the origin. So starting from the origin, you end up in these states at a certain time tf. Okay. It is a vector space or vector subspace of Rn of the state space. So these are an important consequence. So this means that you have, if you have two states which are reachable from zero, by the property of a vector space, of vectors space, this means that the linear, any linear combination of these two states is reachable from the origin. So if you can go from here to here, and from here to here, you are able to go from any linear combination of these two positions. So, for example, here. And you can go also here. Obviously using different controls, which will depend on the controls you use for going from here to here and from here to here. Okay, let's solve this problem in the sense that let's find the input. First, let's characterize better the set of reachable points from zero, and then let's find the control which steers zero into a final given state, which is a state which by definition is in the set of reachable states from zero. Okay, we use two objects to characterize this. The first object is the so-called controllability Gramian. The controllability Gramian depends on, it is defined on using the matrix exponential. It is the integral in between 0 t of the matrix exponential e to a tau power. B transposed exponential of A tau in the tau. This is known as controllability Gramian. Okay, besides the controllability Gramian, it is important to consider another object. And this object will be used in many, in the solution of many control problems we will see. And it is the so-called controllability matrix. The controllability matrix, as you can see, is a simpler object than the previous one. It is a matrix. And this matrix is made up of n columns. And each column is basically A to the power I, B. Ok? So you can form this matrix simply from B and A, the matrices, of the system. First taking B, then multiplying B by A, and so on. A square B, until A to the n power minus 1 B. Ok? You can construct this, for example, like this. B, AB. Then you, instead of a square b, more simply, you can take b, ab, and multiply a by ab. This is simpler than calculating a square, Okay, and so on. So taking the previous multiplication, this is a computational remark. Okay, so we have one important result. For each t different from zero, remember the span or the image. The span is the set of all possible linear combination of the columns of a matrix. So the span of a matrix, we use this in the first lessons, is the linear combination of all the columns of the matrix. So the span of G of T is equal to the span of R. The set of reachable states XF from x0 equals 0 in time tf is equal. Remember that this set is a subspace, is a vector subspace. So this vector subspace is exactly equal to the span of GTF. So this is a okay, exactly the characterization of set of reachable states from zero in time TF. It is equal to the span of the controllability Gramian at time tf. Moreover, you see that at the same time you have also this. Okay, so if you read well this, this equality is for all t different from zero, while r is not depending on t. So this means that the span of GTF is equal for all t. It's constant. And it is equal to the span of R. Okay, so the span of the controllability Gramian for each t non-zero is always the same. And it is equal to the span of R, the controllability matrix. Moreover, you see from the second statement, the set of reachable states from zero in time tf is equal to the span of gtf, so at time tf. But since the span of gt is constant, remember that this is, however, always equal to the span of R. Okay, so which is the conclusion from the second statement? Another important conclusion from the second statement. Is that you see this result basically does not depend on the final time. So what matters is only the final point, not the time in which we steer the state in this point. So, in other words, the set of reachable states from zero is independent of the final time. Okay? Now, remember the solution. You remember the solution xt x zero u is this. Okay, so the set of reachable set, the set of reachable states from x zero, so as you as we said before, basically the final time has no. It's not important. So, it is equal to this set of states. You see, x zero is zero. So notice that this is, what is this? Is the first state, the first state response. So basically, the set of reachable states from x zero equals zero is exactly when the first response of the state is equal to the final state. This is TF, excuse me. You see. Here, you have to correct here. TF. Because TF is here. Okay. So now, what is the set? So the set of reachable states from the origin is this, is what you see here. And as we said before, is equal to the span of the controllability matrix. Or the span of the Gramian at any time, basically, different from zero. Okay, so now we want to characterize the set of reachable states from any initial value x0, not only from zero. So the set of reachable states from x0, any, at TF now the final time is important. It's not important for the set of states reachable from zero. The set of reachable states from x0 at TF will be this. Obviously. So, you see, we have to take into account also the unforced state response. So exactly the contribution is this to this set of points. So notice also that you have a kind of sum. This is what you can reach from the origin. And this is the additional term for which you can move basically from any initial state, x0. So this gives the important conclusion here, which is that let's compare the set of reachable states from zero with the set of reachable states from x0 any. You see that if you take this term on the other side of this equality, you get what? You get a state which is reachable from zero because it's equal to this. So if you put this term on the other side of this equality, okay? You will get that XTF x0 u minus this is equal to 0 TF A TF minus T B u T in the tau. Okay. So you see that this is exactly what you can reach from zero. So we have the following conclusion. You see that you can say that a state XF is reachable from X0. If this irreachable from x0 equal 0. So it's a reachable set from 0. Okay, so you can say this. XF is reachable from x0. Okay, not zero in TF seconds if XF minus this is reachable from 0. Which means what? That this must be in the span of R. So this means reachable from zero. Or the Gramian. Okay. Okay, so let's now see how to construct these sets. So how to obtain practically these sets. So it's important to understand which is the set of possible points we can reach from zero and from any other point. Okay. So this will be exactly what we will do here now. So now we will calculate these sets. Okay. On the basis of these results and conclusions. Then we will find the control for steering the initial state into a final state. So basically, first we have to understand if a certain point is not or yes reachable from a certain point. And then we will design the control to steer the state, initial state, into the final state. It makes no sense to look for a control if, for example, a certain initial state cannot be steered in a given final point. So first it's important to characterize the set of reachable points, and then it makes sense to look for the control which takes a certain initial state which is given into a certain final state, which obviously is in the set of reachable states. Okay, so the set of reachable sets from zero, as we know, is the span of R. So is the span of R, or the span of the controllability Gramian at any point, at any time, as long as it is non-zero. Actually, from the constructive point of view, we will use the span of R, which is obviously easier. So it's the span of a matrix. So very easy to determine. Okay. Now, how to calculate the set? So, from a practical point of view, we will calculate the set of reachable points from zero as the span of R. The set of reachable states from x0, in general not zero, in tf seconds is this space which we have to calculate. So will be the space of vectors z, which can be written as follows. And this obviously follows from here. Remember the result we obtained here. So on the basis of this theoretical characterization here, we will be able to calculate practically this set of points. So it's the set of points z in Rn, the state space, such that z can be written. So let's see above. You see that an x A state xf is reachable from x0, non-zero, if this is reachable from zero, which means is in the span of R. So z is a reachable set, a point from a given x0 if it is the sum of what? This and any element in the span of R. Okay. So you see how to calculate this set. Once you have the span, you have any set, you have any elements inside here. And then you simply have to calculate this. So in particular, you need here to calculate the exponential here at the given TF time. Ok. So let's see an example. So this is a double integrator. So, first of all, we want to determine the states reachable from x0 equal 1, 0. Okay, before actually doing this, if we remember before, we would like first to calculate the states reachable from zero. So this is actually the first step. In particular, because this is equal to the span of R. Let's add the state reachable from x 0, 1, 0 in tf equal 1 second. So we are also given the final time. Okay, so let's do this before. So let's see which is the set of states which we can reach from the origin. So from the origin, first we need the matrix A and B. The matrix A is 0, 1, 0, 0, you see? And the matrix B is 0, 1. The controllability matrix R is B, A, B. And the reason is that n is the dimension of the state space, which is two, double integrator, two states. Okay, so the controllability matrix is exactly B, A, B, by definition. Okay, so this matrix is equal to what? Zero, one, and AB is 1, 0. The span of R is a vector subspace, and how in general we can easily determine this span? Well, remember, the span of a certain matrix, we can determine the span of a certain matrix simply looking at the matrix and searching for the independent columns. This will be a base of this space. So, which are the independent columns inside R? Both. Okay, so this is equal to the image or the span. Let's use the span because image may be confused with the imagery, with the imaginary part, okay? So let's use span of 0, 1, 1, 0. But this span, what is what? It's R2 because we have two independent two-dimensional columns. So this is exactly R2. It's all the space. So the set of reachable states from the origin is the entire space. So this means that we are able to go from zero to any other point in the space with a suitable control input function, which you don't know yet. But we know that, this is an important information here, that the set of states which we can reach from the origin in a certain time, and remember that here the final time is not important, so this means in any time, no matter what the final time is, we can reach all points in the state space. This is a typical property of integrators, in particular here the double integrator. Now, what is the set of reachable points from any other point? So remember that we have to characterize this set we are given a certain final time, tf, a certain initial x0, plus v, where v is any element of span of R. So we have to determine this set. However, so this is any element of R2 because span of R is R2. But so we are looking for vector Z, which are given by any vector in R2 plus this part. But this means any vector in R2. Because here V is any vector in R2. So in the end, Z may be any vector in R2. So this set is also R2. Okay, basically we have these general conclusions. Remember this. When span of R is all the space, which means what? That the set of reachable states from zero is all the space. So any state can be obtained from zero in a certain time with a suitable control. Okay? The set of reachable states from x0 non zero is again Rn. In other words, if the set of reachable states from zero is all the space, also the set of reachable states from any other state is the entire space, state space. Or if you want, if you can steer the state from zero to any other state, you can steer the state from any initial state to any final state. Okay? If span of R is Rn, we will say that the system is fully controllable. And the meaning of this is exactly that we are able to steer any state into any other final state. So we can go from any point in the state to any other point in the state space. Okay. So let's see a final example, short few minutes, in which the system is not fully controllable. So let's consider a single integrator, you see? Single integrator. And here you have some kind of appended dynamics. So you have a single integrator with some additional dynamics below. You see that the problem here is that with the control, you are not able to influence the behavior of X2, you see. We are only able to change the dynamics of X1. But we are not able to change the dynamics of X2 with the control. So, you see that the matrix A in this case is 0, 0, 0, 1. B is 0, 1. The controllability matrix is B, A, B, which is 0, 1, 0, 1. So now you see that something has changed, and the span of R now is the span of 0, 1. Excuse me, I got an error here. Not 0, 1, B. It's 1, 0. Excuse me. Let's correct. Here. And here. So it's 1, 0, 0. Okay. This is the new correct here. Okay. So below also. Also correct here. So 1, 0. So the set of reachable states from zero now is not R2, but you see, one, any vector parallel to 1, 0. So this means that you are able only to change what? Or reach the states, the vector 1, 0, x1, x2, you see? Is this. This means that you can reach all the states from zero which lie on this line. So, graphically, this means that you cannot exit from this line with the control. So, in some sense, you are trapped in this line. So this is the set of reachable states from zero, which is the set of reachable sets, reachable states from a different x zero. For example, let's say 1, 0, excuse me, 0, 1. Notice that in this case you are outside this, you are here. So the initial value, it's here because it's the vector 0, 1. So you want to know which are the possible reachable states from here. Remember that if you are inside this line, you can move only inside this line. Now, if we start outside, what happens? So remember that we have to calculate this set. Okay, the exponential matrix, it's easy in this case because A is diagonal. Remember that when A is diagonal, the exponential matrix is the diagonal of the exponentials. And so here we have this. So ATF x0 is equal, you see, to 0 ATF. Which is also equal to ATF 0, 1. Okay. Let's conclude our search. So we look for all possible elements Z, which can be written as here. Okay, this is equal to 0, 1, ATF. And this is any element in the span of 1, 0. So if we parameterize, we obtain ATF 0, 1 plus any element inside here will have the form A0. Okay, so finally, what you obtain? So all the possible reachable states from x0 must have this form. So you see what happens. If you start from zero, you can reach all the states here. If you start from here, x zero equal zero, one. You see what happens? You can reach all the states at that level. You see, here, basically, the states, excuse me, let's take this value, which will be, I don't know, something here. This is A to TF, this value. Okay, this value. And the first coordinate doesn't matter. So this means that you can reach all these elements. Okay, so for example, in 1 second, you can reach all the elements with level E. In 2 seconds, level E to the second power, and so on. So you can reach all parallel lines. from that point. And notice, to conclude, one important thing, that you are able only to reach the states which are above, not below. Because, you see, TF is positive. So you can cover only these states. You can steer only to these final states, not here. So you can also say that, you see, this part of the plane is not. It's not possible to be, is it not possible to go in this part of the space with no control. You can only increase. You can only go in this part. This is x0. So you can only obtain this part of the state, not the below part. Okay, we finished for today.